One reason why I think answering the question of what liberalism is difficult is because, like any ideological tradition, the content of liberalism has evolved and developed over time through political conflict and historical change. So at different historical junctures, liberals have been more or less for and against the state. They've been more or less pro and anti-democracy, and they've quite likely been on both the right at some times and on the wrong side of lots of different political debates and arguments. If one thinks about the liberalism that emerges from quite a long period of social transformation 3.5 centuries ago, it's a radical and obviously at times revolutionary movement. In opposition to social hierarchy and privilege, diverse thinkers such as Hobbes and Locke and Montesquieu and Tom Paine and Smith and Kant, and ultimately in the culmination of liberalism in the English tradition, John Stuart Mill, they develop different ideas that build a model of the individual and a model of society. And these ideas, I think, prioritise the notion of individual rights and freedoms as fundamental to social organisation. They prioritise a model of humanity that is universal and egalitarian in a quite important way. They create and demand a suspicion of unjustified power, not least the power of the state, and a demand that power and authority should be both subject to justification and continuously held to account. They prioritise reason over superstition and prejudice in the organisation of our social lives. These core ideas start to do is to build a model of what it is to be a human being at this particular historical juncture, a creature capable of rational thought, with potential autonomy, with the capacity for self-development, a bearer of rights, and someone who shares in this universal human condition and human experience. And I think these are the ethical core features of liberalism, which are increasingly undermined and maligned and under attack in different ways. Is that also involves a willingness amongst those of us who tolerate each other's profound differences to actually think that it might be important enough to work through those differences and to argue about them. So again, I don't think tolerance means that I recognise and respect what you think. I recognise and respect you as someone capable of thinking, but I actually take the ideas and the values and the principles which are at stake seriously enough to think that your ideas are worthy of criticism and challenge and robust debate.
What I would like to argue in this forum is that American libertarianism is essentially 21st century liberalism, and I mean that in the best sense, in that what libertarianism takes from the historic kind of understanding of liberalism, of classical liberalism, and even to a certain degree a kind of contemporary liberalism of an expanded welfare state, is that it stresses equality before the law, it strives for equality of opportunity, and it believes in pluralism and tolerance, and a robust public sphere of public debate about what are the best ways to live. And not to use coercion, but to use moral suasion and example in order to get to a place where more people are able to become their kind of maximal self. It empowers individuals and groups by limiting the state and the scope of the state to control various aspects of our lives, of our political lives, of our commercial lives, of our economic lives, of our personal lives. It allows people to experiment or to run what John Stuart Mill called experiments in living, which we can learn from.
Democracy, in this view, and I think that's a proper view, is a mechanism of electing political leaders. That's the way you get your authority. You just go and elect them. But to say that the state is democratic doesn't say very much about how it is actually run. It just says how you get your politicians, how you get your authorities elected. So then the liberal component kicks in. And liberal, by contrast, is about the norms, practices that shape political life. So a liberal state is one in which individual rights are protected by the rule of law. It protects this kind of state protects the individual not only against the abuses of a tyrant, but also against the abuses of democratic majorities, because democracy can also be very illiberal. Without a healthy liberal component, democracy can easily turn into tyranny of what de Tocqueville called a tyranny of majority, or rather, given that the ruling parties hardly ever get the actual majority of the vote, it's the tyranny of the best organized minority. So without this liberal component that we have in our democracies, we can easily lose what we take for granted. What I'm trying to say is that there is no democracy without this liberal part, or at least it cannot last very long.
The central argument I want to make is ultimately one slightly of a criticism, and that is that I believe that in our society today, liberalism has got out of balance with love. What do I mean by that? Well, liberalism is a place where we have space and we have freedoms and we have rights and we have a huge space to develop ourselves as individuals. But by love, I mean perhaps communitarianism, something that pulls us closer together, while liberalism sometimes makes us feel further apart. I mean something about community, about responsibility, about loyalty, about our identity. I'm talking about our emotional connections to each other beyond our sense of individual atomized agents. And I think that part of Trump and Brexit and these moves towards illiberalism is a reaction to liberalism without love in our society. And the challenge for the modern left, certainly as I see it for Labour, is to be able to embrace love as much as it has done liberty. A liberal can, I think, end up walking far too far down a completely blanket free market path. I think perhaps the biggest thing that liberals without love fail to understand is that for many people, change has not been a positive, productive thing in their lives. I think liberals view change as progressive and always positive, whereas for a lot of those people out there, preservation of and sanctity and loyalty and protection of some of those things you hold dear are really, really important. To understand and to protect liberalism in the long run, we are going to need to do love better at the same time.
Jim, you mentioned that tolerance is often confused with indifference. I would say rather that it's confused with politeness or being nice or indeed love. And this isn't what tolerance demands, is it? Tolerance includes and involves sometimes very harsh argument, you know, vigorous argument, satire, things that might hurt people's feelings but not hurt them. It's intolerant people who kill and censor those who they disagree with. So when we try to make laws that ban offensive speech, you know, things that might offend, let's say, Muslims or indeed Islamists, you're not protecting moderate Muslims at all, or tolerant Muslims. The only ones you're protecting are completely intolerant Muslims. Communitarianism is not liberalism at all, because liberalism gives primacy to the individual as a rational agent, not as someone whose role is shaped by obligations to family or community or church or religion.
I was just wondering the opposition between liberalism and democracy. I don't think it applies if you say that democracy can be the tyranny of the majority. I think it's very important to point out that the tyranny of the majority is no more a democracy than the tyranny of one man. If you have the tyranny of a majority, then the minority, who are part of the citizenry, part of the demos, are being treated as less equal than the citizens contained in the majority. Hence, democracy falls apart. The essence of democracy is like playing a game. Three individuals come together, like, let's say, 100 of them come together. They wish to decide whether to leave the EU or any other kind of collective decision. And they say the only fair way to do this in a community of equals is to let the greater number of equals prevail. And then they agree at a certain date to make a decision and beforehand debate it. And then the winner wins. And that's not oppressive. That's just how you make decisions in a free society.
Pretty much the main sort of criticism of liberalism is that it's a little bit passive, essentially, that there's no... it assumes that everyone, I think it was said here, each person is a sort of rational agent able to maximise their own welfare. But it doesn't really talk about those, I guess, people who are less, who are more disadvantaged for whatever reason.
I think very often what passes in the current discussion is actually a very undemocratic liberal model, which is premised upon the idea that actually people are not really very good at making decisions. They're not really very smart. They're not really very capable of making important decisions. And when it comes to the debate between liberalism and democracy, I think I'm a Democrat first and foremost who wants to instill certain liberal principles within there. I think that's also for me the difficult tension with with communitarianism, because communitarianism has the potential to be hugely coercive. That's its problem, isn't it?
The liberalism puts limits on the kind of decisions you can take democratically, because Brexit is a clear example. That the majority voted, you agreed on the procedure, the decision is taken. You should follow it. So whether I think it's a good or bad decision doesn't really matter. But there are obvious limits to that. If, for example, those who won this vote decided to the Remainers should not be granted civil rights anymore because they have a different opinion, that would be going too far, even if the decision was taken democratically. And the same goes, obviously, there are very examples of many situations in which it is contestable. For example, only recently, the Catalan referendum. Should you follow the democratic decision of the Catalan people, or should you respect the individual rights of all those people who voted against or were not taken into consideration when the vote was taken because they live in different parts of Spain? The same goes, for example, in the United States. Should former prisoners be deprived of their civic rights? You can take this decision democratically. We agreed that those people who spent, let's say, 5 or more years in jail should never regain their civil rights. It's a democratically taken decision, but is it right and is it in accordance with liberal democracy? I would say no. So I agree, liberals put limits on democracy. That causes tension because you always have to kind of negotiate which decision can be taken democratically and maybe which should be somehow, you know, left aside because that would be going too far. Just to say, let's be democratic and get rid of liberalism is in the long run will cause more trouble than bring benefits. That was my argument.
The best response to the tyranny of the majority is more debate, more engagement, more argument, more criticism. You hold the ideas of the majority to account and you try and win people over. Now, I don't think that means we don't need a basic framework of rights. I can go with that. But what I'm getting at is that I think at the moment our tendency is to move up, is to think that just because we've got a majority that we don't agree with, then that's the end point, isn't it?
How liberal are we when we are looking at a Brexit voter or someone who voted for Trump? Do we just dismiss them as irrational? Are we really just criticising the views, or are we actually undermining them as people? And I think until we respect them truly as people, we are in danger of undermining our very own liberalism that we claim to protect.
The sort of checks and balances that you're talking about make me really nervous. And because ultimately all of these checks are checks on the people. They are checks on our right to elect a government of our choosing, whether liberal or illiberal. And, you know, I wonder if that is that an expression of a lack of faith in the liberal project, that, you know, people do often contrast it to democracy. Is there a belief that people can't be won over to liberalism, that it you know, it should just be an elite thing that should just be decided and in place constitutionally so the buggers out there can't fiddle with it too much?
You cannot put restrictions on democracy and claim to be liberal by putting any kind of restrictions on democracy that is by its very nature illiberal.
How far do the panel think that liberal societies can afford to tolerate the intolerant?
Would you ban Supreme Court? It's a highly undemocratic institution, which sometimes overrules the will of the people. Many people may be in favor of restoring the death penalty, but the Supreme Court can say that, for not in the United States, but in any other countries, that it's against constitution, we should not change it. Constitution, again, a highly undemocratic tool, because usually it's very difficult to change it, especially, for example, in the United States. Again, another example from the United States. Let's say after the Civil War, if you followed the voice of the people in the South, they would restore slavery immediately. Should you allow to do it, or should you somehow limit their ability to make that decision? That's, I would say you should, because it infringes upon other people's rights. In his famous essay on liberty, John Stuart Mill says that the freedom of one man ends where the freedom of the other begins.
Mill's kind of criteria about harm, I think, is really interesting, because he wants us not to harm each other, and then people often say, well, he doesn't tell us what harm is. But actually, he does. He's very clear. He says harm is harm to the permanent interests of mankind as a progressive being. And I think that's an aspect of liberalism that I think is hugely important. That notion of mankind as a progressive being, that notion of all of us as being capable of transforming ourselves and taking ourselves forward, and that actually the limits that we want to impose upon each other are as thin as those limits which prevent us preventing that possibility of social development and further social engagement with each other.